and as a freelance music journalist, and has in Berlin founded Tailored Communications, which is one of the biggest or most important agencies for underground electronic music, with clients such as Hyperdub, 50 Weapons, Hot Flush, and others. Then we have Francine Gorman, is that pronounced correctly? Good. Who works for the Linus Best Fit as the features editor, and for Ya, which is also a London-based website that is, I think, affiliated to Linus Best Fit, is it?
Yes.
And which focuses on Scandinavian music. Before that, she has lived in France, in Toulouse and Paris for a while, and worked for Liaison Rock. And do you still work there?
Sometimes
still works for Liaison Rock and for Vivo France. Next one is Alexandra Dröner, who is one of the Berlin nightlife legends, who has been an essential part of, it's true though, an essential part of Berlin's nightlife for more than 20 years. So since the very beginnings of techno in Berlin, I'd say, who has worked as a music journalist for a while, as an editor for Electronic Beats and Debug and Style and the Family Tunes, and who is nowadays mainly a DJ and a promoter. A DJ as one half of Sick Girls, if you ever come across them. Next we have Ruth Saxelby, who is the editor of Dummy. Associate editor of Dummy, sorry. And who works as a freelance journalist for example, Pitchfork, Dazed and Confused, what else do we have? The Fader magazine, NPR, and The Guardian Guide sometimes. And who has just started a column for Electronic Beats about new American underground music? What is
it? It's about finding themes and the wealth.
Okay, so I think you can't hear that, right? If she just talks without a microphone. Okay. So a new column on Electronic Beats, anyway. And then we have John Doran, who is also from London, just as Ruth, who is the founder and editor of The Quietus. You should know that website if you don't learn. And who has worked for various magazines and websites in the past, including Metal Hammer. This was news to me. It's great, though. Enemy, The Wire, the BBC, and Vice, and others. And actually, I would want to start with you, John, because when I invited you to this panel, you sent me an email back and you said, I will come. But nowadays, I quote you, this is literally the only subject I get asked to talk about. So my question is, why do you think that is?
How do we know that music journalism isn't dying? I'll tell you how we know it's not dying, because we're currently sat in a building the size of a fucking air hangar, surrounded by loads of people who've been paid here to come and listen to us talk about music journalism. If I had a pound for every one of these panels that I've been on, or for every time I've been interviewed by other publications about the death of music journalism, I'd have enough money to take everyone on this panel out for fish and chips, you know. So I'm not talking a fortune, but still a lot of money. I think what you have to need to do is to break down the concept a little bit. Is music dying? Music isn't dying, just the forms of putting, various old forms of putting music out there and the means of making a load of money off of music are dying. Music isn't dying, music isn't going anywhere. There's more music now than there ever has been. And as a consequence, there are more people talking about music than there ever have been in the past. What we're actually talking about is, can we still earn an obscene amount of money like we used to do from writing about music? No, we can't. I think that's a really good thing. So my problem with these panels is, when it's talking about the death of music journalism, is that it's a statement made using brushstrokes that are too broad. It's a generalization, and as all generalizations go, it's just worthless.
Okay. Thanks for that opening statement. That was... I want to get on with Melissa, because you were the other one who actually sent me an email back with preliminary thoughts on the topic. And you have a... There's a microphone for you. You have an opinion on the development of music journalism, at least, that...
Just that it's completely different to how it was when I was a child or a teenager. Like, the need for it has changed. When I was younger, it was about... I couldn't discover artists. I couldn't connect with them without music journalists and these magazines. And now we have social media. We have every label and artist is connecting directly with the fans. And often with video and things, I'm pre-MTV, kind of. So it's just the function has changed. That's not a death. That's a... re-evaluation, I guess. And the other thing is the internet has taken so much power away, I guess, from the journalists themselves.
Just to make that clear, I hope that the death part of that topic title was a provocation that I don't believe in.
Yes, so not a literal
don't
death.
Get me wrong on that. But yeah, before we come to the current or active journalists again, I wanted to ask Alex, you as a DJ, I guess, need to keep yourself informed about music all the time. And what role does, if we hear that the role has changed or is changing, what does music journalism do for you in your, like, for you as a DJ or as someone who wants to be informed about music these days? Do you need publications?
Well, I still need publications. It's as Melissa just said, it's really different to when it all started. When I was young, like, a magazine would be like the window into the world, and now it's so many windows that you have to choose which one you actually want to open. But as a DJ, I'm still all over blogs mainly, and all over, you know, more thing, also channels like SoundCloud and so on, and try to get every new bit that I can find. But it's so much out there that you don't have so much time to really get into it. So for me, it's more about like a horizontal kind of way of going into music than going into deep and reading like long articles as I used to have.
Okay, but now to the three journalists, why do we need long articles? Why do we need in-depth reviews still? Ruth, what?
Well, I was just going to pick up on something that Alex just said.
Yeah, then go ahead with that. You can do that too.
About choosing which window. I don't think people choose which window to look through. I think there's a lot of music sites out there, and I'm involved with a couple of them, but I don't think that people just read one. I think we read many of them, and I think one of the things that that kind of interested me about your title, and about because you were coming at it from an angle of there are these huge event album PR campaigns that are trying to push out information and essentially create this kind of homogenized, like, music publication kind of landscape. And I think that publications have a choice whether or not to, like, engage with those albums. I mean, for me, those three albums that you mentioned, Daft Punk, Boards of Canada, and the Kanye album, they're not big albums to me. I'm interested in, like, tiny little ones like Wonder Group from Brighton or Fatima Al-Ghadiri from Brooklyn. And I think the exciting thing about the landscape today is that there is room for specialism like never before. And I think that we don't need to all have the same article on the same site, on every single site. And I think there is a fear that if we don't have the big news on the site, that we're not keeping up in this big, like, race to publish everything. And I think that's how you can kind of resist being manipulated by these big unseen forces of the music industry by just choosing to cover what you truly get excited about, because that will be the stuff that will your readers will read, because that's why they're coming to you. So that was my kind of ramble about the opening thing. And I think that people will read long pieces. I enjoy reading long pieces. I mean, why wouldn't you want to read something about something in depth that you enjoy, you're passionate about? I'm a nerd about music. I will often go to the quietest to read Rory's like in-depth stuff about electronic music, because it's coming at it from a different angle than I might.
Are you saying you don't come to the quietest to read my features on thrash metal?
I'm just glad that they're there, John. But I think there's a need for balance for everything. But I think that I think that writers need to just stay true to, I guess, what they're excited about, rather than bending to some pressure by the industry.
Just to clarify, don't get me wrong, the question was, where do I find music as a DJ, right? So yes. that was my answer. Yeah. As a journalist, my point of view is just like yours, yeah. Right? But yeah. as a DJ, yeah. That was, I have to look as quickly as I can for a lot of stuff. So yeah. That was...
That's okay.
Okay, but before we all agree on everything and get too comfortable here... I do see your point, Ruth, and I do agree with you, but at the same time, when I have all your sites in my RSS reader, and right now what I see is basically the same content over and over and over. It's not that it's only that content, but it gets exhausting. So my question would be to you, the three of you, and I'm starting with Francine, what do you try to achieve with your websites? Why should I go there if I see a lot of the content that I see on other sites too?
Well, we like to think that we do it better than everybody else, which is why we do it. But our whole philosophy, right since the start of the line of Best Fit, has been that we focus, mostly on the music that we really care about. So if you go on the line of Best Fit today, you'll find something from Deer Hunter that I wrote. You'll find something about Katy Perry that Rich, who's the editor of the site, wrote. You'll find something from all different genres, but it'll be a passionately written piece about something that we really care about. Obviously, the access that we have to new music, we find a lot of it ourselves. We find a lot of it by going to other people's websites and seeing what they're listening to. We find a lot from working with PRs and them sending us things. So there will be some kind of crossover, but I think the important thing is that you just need to represent your site's views and do it as truthfully and properly as you can. And to not feel pressured into putting other... You know, if somebody that you've worked with a lot on certain projects sends you something... But you don't like it, don't feel pressured into putting it on there, because there's a lot of that goes on in the music journalism world. There's a lot of friendliness and you scratch my back, I'll scratch yours, but that's what we do really try and avoid on our site. We just try and put stuff that we really like or stuff that we feel really passionately against.
John, why do I come to the quietest?
Because Henning, you're a sexy man with good taste. And that applies to all you good people as well. It helps if you have a really angry, depressed editor like me who says to the staff, if you write another word about Miley Cyrus or whatever she's called, I will fucking stab you in the face with a screwdriver. But above and beyond that, you know, look, I mean, seriously, like, I really like the Boards of Canada album. The third album... really, really upset me how bad it was. And this, it's almost back on form. I think you don't need to avoid the hype all the time. Occasionally it's justified. The Boards of Canada album is all right. But if all we did was cover hype stuff, we'd be awful. Now, I wouldn't usually boost myself this much, but as soon as I've got an audience, I'm going to. You know, this year I went to Egypt to a small township outside of Cairo called El Salam City to report on like a newly emergent form of music there called electro charby. I'm still kind of like only a few people are picking up on this now, but through me and the Dutch journalist that I went out with, we're releasing a compilation of the first of this material in the West. We're hoping, if we can, I mean, obviously there's a dictatorship and a revolution in progress there at the moment, and there are all sorts of reasons why young men and women can't travel abroad, but we're hoping to bring some of these artists over. I mean, the thing is like, you've got as much space as you need on the internet. There is space to write about this stuff that literally no one else is talking about and boards of Canada at the same time. I think if you fell for the Jaipal thing, you should be tarred and feathered and thrown off a bridge, but that's a totally different point, you know.
We come to that in a second, yeah.
But yeah, I mean, I think like, I agree with what Francine said. I think like, it, as long as, you know, I think if you're a journalist, you should have tattooed on the insides of your eyelids, stop writing about shit. You know, in the early 70s, like, there was a different, music journalism has always been terrible, right? You know, you can look back at old copies of all music titles and they will always be like 60% rubbish. The difference being in the 60s and the 70s and the 80s, in fact, all the way through to Britpop, sorry, the mid-90s, there was an absolute ton of money in the music industry, money that doesn't exist anymore. So if you were writing about garbage, you know, here today, gone tomorrow, flash in the pan garbage, it'd still be garbage that was being bought by literally millions of people in the early 70s. That's not the case now. So I think now it really is time for journalists to crack down and write about quality stuff. You know, there's not enough time or money left for you to be writing about Miley Cyrus twerking at the VMAs. I might as well be speaking Vogue, and I have no idea what I'm saying. I don't want to know what any of these words mean. But, I mean, if you can distinguish what is good hype stuff and spend the rest of your time going out, it doesn't cost much on a plane. You can go out to Poland and interview underground metal bands, and you can do it for less than 100 quid. We've done it this year. And we don't earn any money, you know, we earn minimum wage at the quietest. But you can go up to the north of Norway and interview some dude who lives in a cave and sings in an accent that only 500 people use. You can do this stuff. It's not impossible. And in the age of mass communication, there's literally no good reason why you can't.
Yeah.
Ruth. Why?
Completely agree.
Okay, but still, what is Dummy about? Because, I mean, you all run quality websites, but you have your own characteristics, I'd say. Like, why? What is...
I think Dummy's main thing is about new music. I mean, we get really excited about whether it's something from Poland, something from France, wherever it's from. We're trying to listen further is a big thing that we're really trying to do. We're also very interested in giving a platform to really in-depth commentary. Like, we have a big series from Adam Harper that I'm a huge fan of. He's a musicologist and also the founder of the Rouge Foam blog. And it's a chance, really, selfishly, to have an essay from him every 2 weeks that I get to read. But it's also proved to be hugely popular. And this is an essay that will scroll, you know, maybe for several minutes sometimes, but people read and comment and get excited because he's taking the time to look in depth at something outside of release schedule. And the release schedule is kind of like this, one of the things I hate about the music industry, being pinned down to this thing where you can only listen to something within a certain time frame and have an opinion about it, you know, yesterday. I think that, like, providing a place where really in-depth and like actual digested, marinated thought is happening is really important, and Adam does a great job of that. We also have a series of other writers like Steph Kretowicz and Amy Cliff, who's the editor, who will really get in what, you know, go a bit further for some of our readers who might not know the beginnings of found sound, and do kind of an overarching thing about, you know, who's the history of found sound and who's using it today, and in what ways is it still, you know, really innovative way to listen and to make music. So I think we just want to follow those threads wherever they are. I mean, it does seem to center around essays and new music for me, but I guess new music is our bread and butter. Hearing something and getting excited about it and wondering why that gets us excited. We never just want to post something. We want to try and figure out where this fits in the grand scheme and why it's tickled us today.
But while I see all your like your particularities and your specialties of your websites, why do I still see a lot of the same content then? Like, what's the...
News stories?
Yeah, or? Like the news bits that like flood my RSS feed. That I'm my RSS reader like every day, like and the same story. Like, why are you even interested in running that then? Like,
well, we actually don't have that many news stories on Dummy. It's a conversation that we have the whole time, and I think it's a conversation that many websites have had over the last couple of years, because I've noticed the flow and ebb of like different sites news stories changing from like somebody said something on Twitter news story, which is not a news story, or you know, to everybody reporting on an album being released, and it's like, well, obviously an album being released is something that happens in the music industry. That's what artists do. But if it's an artist that's a key artist to us that we want to let our readers know about, then we will report on that. But we will let them know that Actress is doing a really cool event collaboration, because that's something that we really care about. But our strategy with news is generally to try and only cover something that we have sourced ourselves originally, or if it's something around an artist that is key for our readers.
But you have a pretty big news section, don't you? So
yeah, that's something that we've been working on this year, actually, because the moral of the story is that news brings readers, and the more really fresh new content that you have to publicize on social media, the more people are going to see it, the more people are going to come and visit your website. So we've been using our news function as a way to get people onto the site, and then to show them around the site, get them clicking on the other content that's there, all of the new music, all of the features, all of that too. But we'll only ever publish news stories on things that are relevant. So we have a lot of media partnerships with festivals and things like that, so we'll publish news about that. Our news editor is a huge Kanye West fan, so if Kanye West even sneezes and it rhymes with something, then he'll do that. But yeah, we use news very much as a function to get people from Twitter onto our website and then direct them from there.
Alex, you read websites. Are you bothered by that content?
I am bothered, but only in a way as, for example, like, you know, I just read this thing on Fact Music, for instance, today, where they just posted an album cover. You know, oh, the album cover from this and this artist is out, which is like, blah, you know, okay, thank you for the information. But what I want to say, as much as the absence of industry money and advertisement money liberated journalism, music journalism, we really have to have a look at what you just said. You want to have clicks, you know, you want to have Facebook likes, you want to have numbers, you want to have also numbers that you can show to potential advertisers, and it's really difficult to make any money with a website still. So you have to have these news bits, just as you said to have you know, like motion on your side, and you have to do that just to attract people and to just keep in movement, because it takes much more time to develop a longer piece with more depth and more insight than just to post some news stories. And so I remember quite well when I was working for Electronic Beats, it was like all about statistics. If the numbers weren't right at the end of the week, you had a problem, right? So you always try to figure out the magic formula, you know, the magic balance in between the great opinion piece that's like, you know, 3 pages long and gets like, you know, goes viral, and the everyday news bits and pieces that you just needed to have this kind of traffic. It's that, like this formula kind of thing.
I do tend to like wonder what the future will be there, because I feel like the magazine, the website world is still behaving like we're in a magazine structure, and I feel like the websites that have done really well over the like or that I'm over the last couple of years or even in the last year are places like Aeon magazine, which I'm a huge fan of, and they publish everything in a whole wide range of subjects, from like religion to astrology to like aliens, anything. But they're always just one in-depth essay a day, and that's it. They've decided what their thing is, and they just do it really, really well. And I'm just curious as to whether like the web can continue to like support so many different sites operating the same sort of model. News, reviews, interviews, mixes, new music, which, you know, that still excites me to a level, but I wonder how we're going to move forward, because we don't have a physical magazine with sections to fill. We have a screen, and you can go anywhere with that. So I'm kind of curious as to where we could go with that.
I would like to pick up Alex's argument. Both of your argument. I see that you need clicks. We all need clicks when we run a website. But I have a feeling, and that is a feeling that is fairly recent, actually, that PR companies have really figured out how to exploit that effect. Like how to, like the whole thing that you just mentioned, like, oh, the band revealed the album cover, the band revealed the track list, things that shouldn't really be interesting on any scale, to me at least. Are suddenly all over the place, like maybe not on your websites, but on Fact, on Pitchfork, on I don't know what else. So you see those pieces, and I think I'm just wondering about the role of maybe PR. You're not here to defend PR, but maybe and your company doesn't do that as far as I see it. Do you think that the role of publicity has also kind of adapted to that necessity of clicks?
You mean, are we exploiting the need for content?
Yes.
But in the same way as the journalists are, they need the information to get the clicks. That's what the editors and the publishers are aware of. And in a way, a lot of PR is feeding that need, the news, an exclusive track, the grand unveiling of the album cover, all this kind of thing. But that's not necessarily new. It's just like the speed with which it's done now because of the internet. There's a lot of, there's this need for content, whether it's videos, free tracks, SoundCloud streams, mixes. This is a new drive, and I think that's taking away from things like that is actual journalism, because it's cheap, basically. We provide it. They don't have to pay anybody beyond that to really do in-depth features, and I think that's a shame, because actually what these sites all do really well is like the Black Sky Thinking, the commentary pieces that you want to read, but then there's all this cheap filler that a lot of sites are relying on rather than paying journalists for really good work, which I think that's a continuing trend.
I don't think sites need clicks. I think they need engaged interaction by a reader. I think we forget that a click is done by a real person. It's not a computer. That you can click on something and be dissatisfied, like Alex was dissatisfied by clicking and only seeing a picture that she could have Google image searched. You know, like, I think that we need to think about not just, well, publishers and journalists and all of us have a responsibility to think about what we're giving something that they couldn't get elsewhere. We're giving them a satisfied read. We're giving them the chance to have a think about something from a different angle. And then they might continue, they might come back again. They might not get turned off by having an RSS feed filled up with the same old crap.
I'd advise any magazine, any website editor not to publish track listings when they come out, and not to publish album art when it comes out, and not to have the same track necessarily that everyone else is running, because it might give you clicks in the short term, but if you treat your audience like they're thick, you know, and then they will end up despising you for it and leaving, you know.
Yeah, it's devaluing what you do, I think, a lot of the time.
Yeah, I mean, like, I'm not saying we never do it. There'll be sometimes somebody will be like, whoa, check out that Iron Maiden cover. We've got to get that up. It's amazing.
Somebody, who would that be?
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, but as a rule, I'd never do that. It isn't news. And like, I don't know, it's just like, I think it's being pragmatic and knowing what is a good story and what has genuine intrinsic worth to people. Not everything. I mean, I guess The Quiet has made its name on doing stupidly long pieces, which was done. I started doing this 5 years ago, and it was my first ever job on a website, and I'd always been print press before then, and I was given like a big list of advice of all the things I needed to do. Everything had to have loads of pictures and YouTubes, everything had to have flash animation, everything had to be bullet pointed, everything had to be under 200 words, and everything had to be really, really simple and concisely explained. And I, just to really annoy my bosses, I ended up making a site that did the opposite of that. So I was like, yeah. Anyway, here's the first piece, 10,000 words long. And, you know, like, it worked. And now, it's got nothing to do with us. It's just a coincidence. But obviously, you all know that long form reads on the internet is a thing now. But I'm just glad to be loosely a part of that, you know. And people can be too negative about what's going on the internet and talking about attention spans and stuff like that. There's enough evidence out there to point that things are actually improving. And, you know, our news isn't always brilliant. Sometimes we publish. Sometimes we'll just quickly rewrite an email that we've been sent from a PR and put it up. But you know what? Our readers want to know that information. It's the quickest way for them to find out. There's nothing wrong with doing that. That's how paper... I come from a newspaper background. That's how newspapers operate, you know. Like, half of the information in newspapers comes from PR people. You know, there's nothing wrong with that at all. As long as you're using the other part of your time to do your own investigations, and like Ruth says, as long as you're actually... or was it Francine? Anyway, as long as you're actually spending some of the time doing individual hard stories that, you know, say like when Block Festival cancelled, we did a big investigation piece into why it went under. This is like a dance festival in London, which went bankrupt with, financially catastrophic turn of events. And and again, like Francine said, you know, if you can isolate who your core artists are and who your readers who come back to the site on a daily basis, who the artists they're really interested in, then maybe there's a case to be put for putting every cough and spit about that band up, because you will be the go-to source of information for that band. But no, just because, you know, I don't know, just because some fucking band who put triangles in the name instead of the letter A or whatever have just done some new demo or whatever. I think the sooner that site stop relying on that easy clickbait, the better.
Yeah. So to just sum that up a bit, your bottom line, you all agree that having that clickbaiting news pieces are kind of the necessary evil these days. Like, they have to do it. So it's to everyone's. It's
but this is
like, but, like, but so
you have to do it.
And I but it's happening.
About knowing when it's actually got an intrinsic worth, and when your readers are genuinely interested in it.
Exactly. It's
this is not what I see when I'm on the web these days. This is not what's actually happening. Maybe on your website.
It's not clickbait if it's actual news. If it's actual news and and relevant and of interest to your reader, it's not clickbait.
Yeah.
I think clickbait is almost stepping outside your normal realm and just doing a story that you know will get clicks.
Yeah.
You know.
And don't forget that you actually have individual editors working at these different platforms, and they might be genuinely interested in that news, right? So you can't really not every editor is looking at the whole big picture like you do every day and then thinks, oh no, there are already five other websites exactly. did that news piece, so we shouldn't do that. You know, the work, just the workflow works differently. So you might really actually want to give out that news because you like it.
Yeah. So, but maybe let's take an example. Let's talk about J. Paul then. That came up briefly. If I don't know if everyone's familiar, J. Paul is a London-based artist who has never put anything out, like except for two singles. Sorry. I think one in 2011, one in 2012. And in April of this year, there was on a Sunday, it was April 14th, there was suddenly an album on Bandcamp. And one very clever blogger found it, I don't know how, and then wrote an investigation piece about it, like that it must be by J. Paul, like uploaded by him. And on the next day, he issued a statement that it was not like legitimately set up by him, and then his record label XL Recordings two days later they issued a statement that it was an illegal leak, and that thing sort of exploded on the internet, and all of you, also the quietest, wrote about it. You did a you all did news pieces. Yeah, you did. And with two updates also, like it's not like nothing that happened.
They were writing about how it's a cynical PR move, actually, weren't they? Rather
yeah.
than
and
like
think,
engaging
like,
with the content.
I think we all believe it was a PR stunt. And the one thing
it must have been.
Yeah,
I don't think it was.
Okay, I'm.
Do you know what I think? It's
I really
genuinely
think it was.
No, it genuinely. I mean, I genuinely believe that either somebody got drunk and just thought, I'm just going to put these up. I'm not sure I believe that
it's
his laptop got stolen, but I do think that this is a guy who's kind of like probably devastated now, because these songs are clearly demos. That I did write about I paid £7 for that, as did two other editors of actual magazines in there. I saw Paul from The Guardian Guide bought it. I saw Tim from Days of Confuse bought it. I know a lot of other people end up bought it generally because they were genuinely excited about the release of this music. He's an artist who's, okay, he's had two songs out that and had an awful lot of hype, but I really liked those two songs. I listened to those two songs, probably in the same way that you might listen to Iron Maiden. But I really enjoyed them and I really genuinely wanted to hear that music. Listening to that release, it was clear that they were demos. But it was confusing as to why they've been put out. But I don't think it was a PR stunt. I think it generated an awful lot of PR. But I think it also means he can't now release that material. And also, he's not made any money off it, because all that Bandcamp ended up having to pay back everybody who actually bought that stuff. And he
yeah,
got
that's
so
true,
much
but...
crap. I think he got so much. Stick for the music, for the quality of the music, when there were a bunch of demos that could have been sitting around for about 3 years. I mean, that's my personal take on it. Who knows? I mean, who knows? Well, I don't really see what the PR gain from it is.
Well, a lot of talk, a lot of
yeah.
publicity. I don't know.
But I mean, like, but what does he? But I mean, I don't see. There's definitely no. There's definitely no monetary gain. There's no. He's now people think he can't make good music because it was all crappy quality.
Let me put it this way: I knew who J. Paul was before I heard that record. That's how much people were talking about him. I don't know fucking anything about anything, and I knew who he was.
Yeah. Okay. But
I definitely didn't need the hype. I just think it was a silly mistake. And I mean, you can see by the way that it was like handled and the time lapse between things that it was like, you know, even like the staff of XL didn't know that had happened. But you could see from
they were tweeting.
Yeah.
Oh,
really?
Yeah. No, I don't. But and
oh,
also my
people love a conspiracy theory. Though.
Yeah.
Like,
maybe it's
I mean,
just
we're
that.
Like,
my
you know,
yeah. I hear other things, but that's not the point. My please.
Just in our defense as well, it's like, you know, when big things happen in the music industry, they are then music stories and need to be reported on. Yeah. I'm not going to apologize for us covering that story, because we always said straight away, if there was actually any editorial on it, which there was, it was WTF, as the kids like to say. What the fuck? This is awful. This is, what the hell was he thinking? You know? So, like, yeah, I'm not going to apologize for us covering it. But the idea that we were kind of dashing out stories going, oh, there's a new album out by J. Paul, isn't it brilliant? Let's get somebody to review it right now. We didn't do any of that stuff. And sometimes, I've got to say, the temptation is there to do that. We, Francine talked about this before, and I'm in total agreement with her. There is a line to which, you know, I think if you do back of an envelope calculations, you for the same amount of readers, you earn something like a tenth of the amount of money as like your print equivalent would through advertising. So there has to be, somewhere in your organization, there has to be stuff that gets people a high content of traffic coming into the site. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean it has to be poor quality, and I would refute any accusations that we do stuff that's poor quality. Since I've stopped taking drugs, I'll claim that anyway. But once a story gets to a certain size, you've got a justification for writing about it. I mean, then I would say that when we did a think piece on it, there was a wider implication about the story was what we're talking about now. That's what our story was. Why did this happen? Why were people so quick to praise this on Twitter? And let's face it, it was. For the first 24 hours, this was being hailed as the greatest album since Pet Sounds. And I was like, I must have a different version, because it's like somebody's picked up a ferret and is squeezing its feces into my ears.
But it was the quietest who was first to accuse basically every other website of clickbaiting regarding that story. Like, Alex McPherson wrote the piece on the quietest, yeah, like, 2 days later.
Alex is an untamed little wild man, though.
I was on your website still. Like,
I know,
like,
but I can't keep Alex on a leash. He's a tiny, angry young man, you know.
I mean, the piece was titled J. Paul, a scam to feed the internet sausage machine.
Yeah, and I totally agree with that piece, and I think he was absolutely right. I mean, like, another thing is, like, I come from a hard news background. In the 90s, I was a newspaper guy in London working on national newspapers, and this is my only disagreement with what Ruth said so far. I really genuinely do believe very strongly in dividing up news, features, reviews, and opinion. And, like, there's a reason why the format for newspapers works so well. It's because it's evolved organically over centuries, not over decades, over centuries. And when we put something in opinion and it's clearly marked as opinion, then that's not the same as a news story. That's something totally different. Opinion pieces are there. They can't be based on untruths, but they are provocative. You know, they are there to start a debate, and that's what that piece did.
Yeah. Okay.
I mean, I disagreed with that piece quite a lot, but I wrote my own piece, but it wasn't so much. We had a series called Song of the Week on Dummy, which was a chance to, like, after that week's releases of new songs, a chance to look at one in depth and talk about whether it, not necessarily praise it to high heaven, but, like, look at why it was an interesting, why it was the interesting story around it. And that week, I chose the one of the tracks from the J. Paul album, and I really liked those songs. I could see that they were songs in an embryonic state. I could hear that they were, like, they had something at the heart of them, and I didn't believe that hype was, like, pouring honey into my ears and making me believe that I was, like, listening to the new Beach Boys album. That's what I essentially wrote in this piece, that I wasn't, as much as you were saying earlier about, like, you know, not all, you don't always have to not engage with the hype machine. I think for something like this, I do believe there's something. Yeah. Jay Paul has something for me. He does something. There's something with his voice and something with his percussive elements that, like, that gets to me. So we made that Song of the Week, and I think I did link back to the Quietus article and say I disagreed with it. But I still enjoyed reading it. I think it's important to have these debates. If we weren't having these conversations about the new ways in which music is getting out there, whether it was meant to or not, then we'd just be all sitting here just having music poured straight into our brains and not questioning it.
I just wanted to say for the record that these things should never be about taste in music. Ruth's got great taste in music. I've got absolutely awful taste in music. If you listen to the records I listen to at home, they're fucking terrible. It's just like, sounds like rhinoceros has been pushed off cliffs, you know. So it isn't about taste in music. It's more about the thing that I'm interested in is more about how we were being manipulated by the story.
Yeah.
Okay, so because time is running out slowly, I want to have a last round, maybe, because I think we, or you all agree, that music journalism is not in the worst state ever, I think. I would like to ask about your opinion where we are headed with online music journalism, mostly online music journalism. This is what we all focus on, incidentally. So what's the future? Is that just everything is fine, nothing needs to be changed, or do we... I would like to start on this side.
It's evolving. So long as sites like the Quietus are doing the range of things that they're doing, so long as there's still room for criticism, like really considered criticism and opinion, then I think it's positive. It's if everybody becomes too obsessed with video and content, then I think we will have problems, but it doesn't seem, from this panel, it doesn't seem like that's where we're going. It seems positive.
Francine?
Mm-hmm. I think websites and, well, music journalism in general, I think everybody needs to become more comfortable with what it is that they are as a music publication. So, I mean, we always separate things out. You have print publications, you have lots of different sectors and different kinds of things in that world. Online, you have blogs where... you know, it's just posting tracks. You have things like Gorilla versus Bear, where it's very much visual and audio content rather than any kind of editorial stuff. And then you have online magazines, and you have the more kind of editorially based things like the Quietus, and I mean, the Line of Best Fit to an extent as well puts a lot more opinion in than the blogs do. So I think once people get comfortable with what their role is and should be, then they can start to make those evolve and work as best they can. As John mentioned earlier, newspapers have evolved over time to become something that functions really well. And I think we're in the very, very much the baby stages of that with online music journalism.
Alex, you might come back to music journalism at some point?
Yes, I might. We'll see.
So is there anything you would want to change?
Well, I think it doesn't really... Let's say it like this. I think we have to see how the money trail is working out, right? If there's gonna be more money in online, then music journalism will change again according to the money flow. Then we have to have a look at the technical development. If we look at pieces like the Pitchfork Daft Punk piece, you know, I think we will have much more multimedia stuff, which is also very attractive for the eye. So I think this is also a big part that could change some things in the future. And then my personal opinion is that the opinion pieces will be much more worth and much more sought after now, because I think like content is going towards opinion right now much more than towards news. We see that when we look at this whatever war porn that Vice is publishing. It's all about opinion and rants. You know, people like that. People like rants, a good rant, like you. And so I think there are really a lot of different things that will influence the future of music journalism, as always.
Well, we had it, Ruth.
I saw a tweet this morning that said, "Complete, everyone, please stop trying to be BuzzFeed." And I thought that was like a, because we've managed to spend an hour talking about modern music journalism and not mention lists. So I just thought I'd bring them in at the end.
Let's mention lists.
Well, I just think as long as we just try and keep that mantra in our head, there's already one BuzzFeed. We don't need to be that. Yeah. You know, we need to know who we are as a publication, as Francine was just saying, and really just get excited about the stuff that we're covering and just figure out new ways of doing that. Like, yeah, I think there's lots to be excited about.
Yeah, I mean, next year, I mean, for the price that I've saved up from, say, not smoking for 3 or 4 months, I'm going to Ethiopia with a Mancunian journalist called John Robb, and I'm going to be blogging there from every day, and I can go there with a computer, and I can meet people making jazz music. I can meet people making really traditional forms of Ethiopian music. And I can file stuff. I can take photographs. I can put it on my computer. And I can file a feature with words, music, and pictures. And it can be up on my site in London, streaming to the whole of the world that day. And, like, you know, I don't even particularly have a big imagination, but, you know, what I'm driving at is like, you know, the field is so wide open, it's unbelievable. And it's like, yeah, there's great music coming out of the UK and Berlin and, you know, San Francisco and Williamsburg and wherever. But really, you know, compared to the exciting music, the real frontiers are in the MENA countries, you know, the Middle East, North Africa, South America. I'm only just getting to grips with stuff that's going on in former Soviet states and Eastern European countries. And I don't know, there's just like, you know, it can feel like music, therefore music journalism, has reached a full stop if your horizons kind of stop at what you're looking for in America or the UK or Germany. But if you look beyond that, things are more exciting now than they ever have been. In future, yeah, the lists. God damn it. Do not post a BuzzFeed link on my Facebook page or I will come, I'll find you, I'll kill you. I'll burn all your livestock as well. These people are the worst people. The worst. There's some of them are my mates, actually. I like them. They're all right. But they're still the worst people who've ever been bought, apart from my mates. Apart from my mates, they're the worst people ever. But, you know, just have a bit of pride in your job. You know, if you're a journalist, be a journalist. There's time to do funny stories and there's time to do serious stories. But there's no space for serious stories on BuzzFeed, so that's where the problem is.
Yeah. Okay, I think we need to stop. If there's one very urgent question, I would allow that. There's... then, this is, yeah. I can hear you, but I think it's recorded, so...
Well, I'm not sure if it's an urgent question, but I figure that all of you guys finance your sites with advertisement, and all of you have said that you don't make a lot of money with that. So I wonder if anyone of you is discussing to change the model to a subscription model, because that's what many newspapers are doing at the moment. All of them... All the newspapers who have quality content, they need to change the model. And I wonder if you agree with the idea that music, I mean, many people think that music should be for free, and music journalism might be for free as well, but you could also contradict that and have a different idea of that.
Well, it's not contradictory. I mean, there are two things to bear in mind there. One, if no musicians are earning any money, then it's obscene for music journalists to earn money, right? But that's a completely digital view, and it's nowhere near as extreme as that. There are still plenty of people making like a little bit of money, not as much money as they used to off it. And to answer the first bit of your question, the way that we're looking at it, and we're literally in the middle of doing this at the moment, so I can comment on this, we've worked out that we could pay all of our staff and all of our writers a decent working wage, which they deserve for the really good jobs they do, me included, you know, I didn't earn any money off the quieters for the first 3 years we were running. And to be honest, I wouldn't have done it if I hadn't have been, you know, I had just given up drinking, so I needed something to do with my spare time, you know. But now we're at the stage where, you know, we really, really have to pay everyone, you know. And it's always been our plan. And we have a goal at the beginning of every year. And the goal for not next year, but the year after, is to pay everyone, including ourselves, money for everything they do. And we've worked out on paper the way to do this is if we had £1 a month off 10%, the most regular 10% of our readers, then we could do that comfortably. And that's how simple it is, really. And, you know, we're going to take that plunge soon. We're going to have a members area. We'll have a subscription. We will be very, very open about what we're going to use the money for. This money is going to go directly into the site and directly to paying people for what they do. There's no board of directors or anything like that. If there was, they wouldn't get anything, you know. So, yeah, we're in the middle of doing that, and I dare say you'll be able to see in a year or two's time whether it's worked or not.
I deliberately left out the money question because I think that's a topic of its own. I don't know if no one throws us off stage. I would love to hear the other's opinion, but I think we are. Yeah. Okay, then, sorry, we need to stop here. Thanks, everyone. Thanks to you for coming. It was a pleasure. And thanks to the audience. Enjoy Bern Music Week.